Let's move on to the next speaker, ma'am. So our next speaker is Dr. Mohammed Faisal, who is an extremely pleasant and a skilled surgeon who is consultant cataract, cornea and refractive surgeon from Eye Foundation Group of Hospital. And at a very young age, he's heading the Erode Center of Eye Foundation. And he would share a very important practical tip for cataract surgery. Dr. Faisal.
Thank you for your nice words, sir. And thank you, Team ARC, Chitra ma'am and Harshul sir, for giving me this opportunity. I just thought of going back to the basic by showing divide and conquer technique in mature cataract with average sized pupil. So the first step in successful divide and conquer lens removal is the creation of an adequate capsular axis. The rexis should be no larger than 4.5 to 5.5 mm and as round as possible and centered on the visual axis. Next step is good hydro procedure as divide and conquer technique requires rotation of nucleus. So good hydro procedure is mandatory. Then comes the phaco settings. Moderate flow, low vacuum and continuous phaco power is needed. Power used is based on nuclear density. Harder nuclei needs higher power as insufficient power causes the phaco probe to push the nucleus forward, resulting in zonular stress. So first, loose cortical fibers and epinucleus overlying the nucleus should be cleared in foot position tomb alone or with minimal application of phaco power. Next step is to sculpt the groove in the center of the nucleus. It is started with bevel up portion of phaco tip. During superficial groove, sculpting should be stopped short of the rexis and the subsequent grooves can be taken beyond the rexis rim. The entire tip should not be buried. Instead, only the half is buried to get the groove uninterrupted. The groove should be 1.5 times the width of the phaco tip to prevent the sleeve pushing the nucleus. During each sculpting motion, the morphology of the lens should be kept in mind. That is, the downslope sculpting initially should be followed by upslope sculpting beyond the center of the nucleus. The ultrasound power should be used only during forward movement of the tip and the foot pedal should return to position one during reverse movement. So on the distal side, nucleus can be sculpted slightly further towards the periphery, but under the site of the entry wound, the groove cannot extend as far periphery due to capsular ring and the angulation of echo tip. So nucleus is rotated and the groove is extended. And now second groove is made 90 degree to the first groove. This may not be wider. A clear reflex in comparison to the rest of the nucleus indicates satisfactory depth. So after which you should not deepen. Once a pair of cross grooves are created on the nucleus, then next is it's a time for cracking. So cracking can be done either by two choppers or with chopper and phaco tip. Here I am doing conventional cracking. Both the instruments are placed deep in the groove and the quadrants are separated with outward and slightly upward motion. Make sure the posterior plate is cracked. If the crack is incomplete, then the instruments can be moved towards unsplit area and repeat the maneuver. So next is quadrant removal. Now the aspiration rate and the vacuum is increased to better draw the nucleus quadrant into the tip. Once the quadrants are in the center, then it is emulsified and aspirated. So in this case, as the pupil is of average size, I didn't go for a pupil expander. I mean, yeah, iris retractor or anything. And the case went very well. Thank you,
Dr. Faisal, for bringing back to us some of those pearls which we used to really hold on to in our earlier days and still would at any time point which comes to that. I just have a question for the expert panel, and of course, Faisal could answer too. You know, when you're stuck with a thick leathery plate in these total cataracts, what are your tips for dealing with them?
Dr. Luthra?
I think he showed a beautiful way to do, perfect four quadrant crack. And all the points are well taken about the width of the trench and everything. All I would like to add here is that while he was able to crack it beautifully, and most often you can, sometimes these leathery cataracts, you know, you can keep struggling and trying to separate the quadrants and they may not crack. So the trick is that you have to go, you know, at the bottom of the pit. You know, sometimes the beginner surgeon will try to crack it by trying to separate superficially, and it will not crack, and especially if it's a very hard cataract. So you have to go deep down into the trench, and you can do a cross-section, you know, cracking maneuver as well, which means that rather than trying to separate the two instruments, you know, to each side, you can go for a cross action thing. And sometimes that gives better vectors or forces to crack these, you know, very hard. And the third thing is that, you know, usually the crack will start from the periphery, and if you are not careful, you will not get the crack almost to the center. The central of the center plate is very important to crack, and you must ensure that the crack is reaching right till the center in the supra hard cataracts. And I'm sure other people can add more pearls to this.
Yes, I think Gaurav, you added, you almost said everything. Except for the fact that at times what happens is that you're not able to crack completely, then you just leave it there and you keep carouseling it, because what happens is you may not break it completely from at 180 degrees from one end to the other. But even if you've done half of it, you can take it exactly opposite to that and then do the other half and then join, you know, the two chops together so that you separate it. So that is one thing that can be done.
So one very pertinent question here is, yes, Mohan sir, you can reply that for the beginners. How do you judge the proper depth of the trenching? Especially in mature cataract where you can't see the red reflex, like in the NS grade 2-3 cataract, you can see the red reflex and judge. What would you advise to the
beginners? These cataracts are very thick. You need to go almost 95% of the depth. 95%. What I would suggest is you go initially, because in divide and conquer, you are using more phaco power, because every time you trench, you are producing phaco power, you're producing stress on the zonules. That is the reason why we don't do divide and conquer for such hard cataracts. Okay, because every time you trench, there is a stress on the zonules. Already the zonules are weak in mature cataracts. You have to be very careful. As you go down, please make sure that your phaco power is less. Okay, because you're going to have less amount of nucleus to cut at that time. So I keep it 100%. As you go down, you keep it around 70%. If you go to the bottom of the trench, keep it around 40%. Otherwise, you can make a burrow hole into the nucleus and rupture the posterior capsule as well. And all other parameters, I think Gaurav has told, and Faisal has also nicely told. Only thing is, in mature cataracts, I saw him doing multiple quadrant hydro dissection. It is not necessary at all.
Yeah,
just do one quadrant hydro dissection. Be careful in hydro dissection. There can be an underlying posterior polar element as well, and you can drop the nucleus straight away into the vitreous. Be careful. You don't have to do hydro dissection at all. You just have to go. Yeah, and
they rotate nicely without hydro.
Absolutely, without any problem.
Yeah.
I think the most important thing is that if you cannot see the posterior capsule, don't do hydro dissection. That is the concept with which you should be moving. And the second thing, which, you know, he, Dr. Faisal, I would like to compliment you for what you have shown, because those of you who are not in the, you know, chopping maneuver, this can be done, and he has adequately shown how it should be done. Another important thing which was being discussed was how to separate that posterior leathery plate. Yes. You know, multi-level chopping, as Dr. Gaurav has said, you go on, hold it, again hold it, hold the with the phaco tip at a deeper level and move the chopper at a deeper level and separate it, because that will put less stress on the zonules. If by any means you find that they are joined together at the stalk, so you lift the stalk slightly and you can emulsify. Once you emulsify the stalk, the pieces separate. That is another very important trick which you can use at times.
I think another thing is you should try to create a narrow trench, you know, not a wider trench. If you have a narrow trench, it helps you in, you know, separating, cracking the nucleus more efficiently. Yes, Dr. Sandeep.
Yeah, so regarding that last point you made, the narrow trench should be done for soft cases, not for hard cataracts.
Yes. Not a cataract,
because
wide
unless
trench.
You make it wide, your phaco needle will not go all the way in.
Yes.
And the other point I'd like to make about sculpting, since the whole divide and conquer is based on sculpting, and sculpting is the main thing, is the main event over here, what we should do is probably turn our microscope from coaxial 0 degrees to 8 degrees. It gives you better depth, you know, so you can visualize as you're going deeper, you know. The other small little point I'd like to make is keep a little more vacuum, because most of us are using a combination of torsional and longitudinal. So most of the time people keep 50 and 60 millimeters vacuum, and then that thing gets occluded. So if you want an uninterrupted pass, keep the vacuum around 120, 130, or even 150, and you can have an uninterrupted pass. And you know, and you can keep on these hard cataracts, keep on sculpting till you can actually see the fibers. Then they're easy to separate. As Gaurav said, go right into the bottom of the crack and then split it, you know.
No, but Sandeep, if you have more vacuum, you'll hold the nucleus.
No,
you don't
want
holdability at that point of time. You want only cutting. You want only cutting. You don't want holdability.
You know what happens, Mohan, is what happens is that you then you achieve occlusion. If you keep the vacuum low, you achieve occlusion and you find that your pass is not so good. Try it next time. Keep a little more vacuum so you don't get occlusion.
I think the vacuum should be on the lower side.
Lower side, because if you have high vacuum, you hold the nucleus and the nucleus will start coming up.
No, you will not hold. It's the direction of your, you know, the direction of your needle. You're basically going to do a bevel up. So you're not likely to hold the nucleus at that stage, you know.
You can easily go up to 100 or not, easily.
That's what I feel.
I think let's move on to the next speaker, ma'am.
Very valid points. And thanks, Faisal, for bringing back to us something valid and which has to be used at times.